Next speaker need no introduction, Dr. Ayman Hammoudeh. He'll be talking to us about closing the circle in anticoagulation care. If I can say while they are doing this, Dr. Mahmoud Athbat, the new curriculum in USA now, they are teaching diabetes management along with cardiology. And actually, cardiologists now are allowed to treat diabetes in many programs in USA.
Okay. Thank you. If you look at the 10 most important medicines in the 20th century that we use almost on a daily basis, you'll see that aspirin stands in the middle of them. In addition, it's a small script, but it's mostly vaccines. So aspirin and digoxin are one of the best medications in the 20th century, and I think based on that, probably DOACs will probably take the same stand in the 20th century. And this is the third talk about this important medication in this Congress. So to close the circle on all of the DOACs that has been mentioned, I think the circle has four quadrants. So the most important one is having one decade data. And speaking about the Bigatran, Pradaxa, we will show you the decade data on the RELY from 2009 to 2019 and how stroke treatment treatment and prevention of stroke in AFib has evolved. The second part of the circle is the having a medication with two choices that you can use. And number three, the answer of the same possibility that was answered by the two speakers yesterday, when the acute coronary syndrome collides with atrial fibrillation, and again we have a study from that. And finally, if we have a reversal medication that you can use once indicated in terms of patient with life-threatening bleeding or who needs an emergency surgery. So the global burden of AFib in 1990 was about 7 million, and in the year 2060, you will have about 18 million of atrial fibrillation. So it's about 1 in 4. And the source of all even is the clot that sits in the left atrial appendage, and that will just embolize to the brain or any other place. Now we know that now aspirin, as you see in the red box, aspirin for atrial fibrillation is not only gone with the wind, it's also gone with a whiff. So no more antiplatelets to prevent atrial fibrillation in patients who have you want to prevent a stroke. At the same time, the vitamin K antagonist warfarin, again, is now by the guidelines is second to the new oral anticoagulants. However, and despite all of the data that you see, only one in two of patients who are eligible to these medications, the DOACs, actually are receiving medications, and if so, probably they aren't receiving the appropriate dose. I'll just take 2 minutes to show you interim results of the Jordanian Atrial Fibrillation Registry, JOFIB, that probably most of you are contributing cases. And we have some data on the first 1,000 cases. The registry is registered in Washington at theclinicaltrials.gov with a protocol unique number that you can check through which the progress of the study. And hopefully it will put Jordan on the map of the atrial fibrillation studies, because there is only one in the Gulf and very small one in Egypt. And you can see we have more than 19 hospitals and 20 clinics that are participating. So the case number one was enrolled on the Independence Day, 25th of May, and we expect to get in the 2020 Independence Day, the case number 2000. And we're so lucky that actually a couple of days ago, on the passage of 6 months, we enrolled patient number 1000. So this is the age group of the first 1,000 atrial fibrillation in Jordan. And you can see only less than about 2% only are younger than 30. And you have most of the patients, 49% in the 60s and mid-70s, and above 75 is another 29%. So adding these, you can easily say that 8 out of 10 patients in Jordan with atrial fibrillation are older than 61. And this is the first time in our registries you will see this shift to the right, so to speak, because basically our acute coronary syndrome studies looked at younger age group, as the other speakers alluded to in the previous sessions. And this is the first registry that we see now women are commoner than men when are enrolled. Almost 20% of acute coronary syndrome patients are females. However, in Jordan, 55% are women in atrial fibrillation and 45% are men. And this is the slide that all of us have been looking for, but definitely more data on the 2000. And this is the CHA2DS2 VAS score in these patients. So CHA2DS2 VAS score 1 or 2 only, 4% and 9%. So 13% of Jordanians with AFib, they do not need oral anticoagulation, and you can say easily that the rest, more than 80% actually, have CHA2DS2 VAS score more than 2 or more, I mean. And look at the peak goes with CHA2DS2 VAS score 3 and 4 and 5. So this is very important to look because it has an implication on our use in these 1,000 individuals of the oral anticoagulant, vitamin K antagonist and DOAX. So if you look at the 13% who have a score 1 or less versus those who have a score 2 or more, you see that we have 13% and 87%. So let's look at the gross use of this medication. So 80% actually have been prescribed warfarin and DOAX. 45% DOAX, warfarin 35%. But if you remove from these 800 plus patients, if you exclude those with valvular atrial fibrillation, those who and prosthetic heart valves who need warfarin for sure, let's see what happens to the indication. So now you have 60 to 40%. So 6 out of Jordanians receive DOAX, and 4 who do not have by guidelines an indication for warfarin, probably we'll talk about cost or something else, but per guidelines, this is what you have, 6 to 4. So probably our data will show more than half of the patients who are eligible receive the medication. So Jordan data will show probably 7 to 8%, which is good starting interim data. So in 2019, when the RELIZE study was announced in Barcelona in the ESC that year, the presenter said, quote, and this is the first time in more than 50 years that a new oral blood thinner has been developed, which has been found to be safer and more effective than what we have, meaning warfarin and aspirin. And that was the landmark RELIZE study, which showed that at both doses you have benefit in these patients. And the fear of bleeding, which is almost comes in our society especially, in addition to the stroke issue, you have the issue of the intracranial hemorrhage at the bottom of the slide, and it shows you at the doses of 150 twice daily, the dark blue dot, and the dose which is 110, the light blue dot, intracranial hemorrhage is definitely less in these patients. So definitely, compared with warfarin, these medications are better. That was a randomized trial. Probably you'll say that it was looked for. A lot of researchers look at these patients. They follow them up, etc. So what about the real-life data? Again, this is the superiority of the Bigatran safety and efficacy versus warfarin across EU. You can see, again, all of the endpoints are in favor of the Bigatran when you look at the usual practice, not only via a randomized clinical trial. And that was probably the first study to give us a paradigm shift in the treatment. And actually, the first guideline said that probably you have DOAC as an alternative to warfarin, and eventually now DOAC are the choice better than warfarin when you look at the non-valvular atrial fibrillation, stroke, and systemic embolization prevention. Okay, so that was a study and real-life study. What about the long-term data? Now we have data on the extended RELY, they call it RELIABLE, and they showed extension into further 6 years and further data on the long-term benefit of this medication. And again, you can see that the bleeding and the stroke and systemic embolization did not give us any surprises in terms of excess bleeding or excess risk of systemic embolization. So the first quarter of the circle of DOAC is the long-term data. And now we have, again, in this with Predaxa, we have two doses, and these doses, actually, the 150 and the 110, have been studied in a long and a large number of studies, whether you are talking about at the bottom of the slide, concomitant use in subgroup analysis, the atrial fibrillation cardioversion, the patients who undergo ablation, etc., and finally, the patient who comes with an ACS that collides with atrial fibrillation. So someone like this patient with a tight LAD lesion and the ECG, in addition to the deep inverted T waves in the lateral leads, they come with atrial fibrillation, and patient now leads triple therapy. The first study that looked at such population was the REDUAL, and when they look at the Bigatran in two doses compared with plus P2Y12 inhibitor compared to the standard care, two antiplatelets plus warfarin, what did they look at? They looked at the primary endpoint, which is major bleed or clinically relevant non-major bleed. And you can see that with both doses, the bleeding was less when you compare the Bigatran-based therapy versus warfarin-based therapy, which has two more platelets with this medication. What about the thromboembolic endpoint? Again, the endpoints of death, thromboembolism, unplanned revascularization, it was non-inferior, meaning that you do not expose your patient to more events, especially stroke or stent thrombosis, when you downplay the role of the Bigatran plus one of the two other antiplatelets. And actually, the REDUAL was part of two recent meta-analyses, both published in 2019. One was last month and one was in June. And the network of all of the medications that we talked about in this conference, the DOACs, and this is the network of the trials that looked at them. So you have a medication that was tested against NOAC and DAPT or two platelet inhibitor, etc. But the faint yellow line between vitamin K antagonist and the antiplatelets versus at the bottom the NOAC plus P2Y2 inhibitor was the REDUAL, and they have ended up with one slide very important to remember. These are 13 endpoints, bleeding and ischemic, and we're all in favor of DOAC. So in the red squares, these are the bleeding problem, and actually most of them, the majority of them, favor the use of DOAC. So bleeding scare should be dissipated with this medication. The blue squares look at the cardiovascular deaths, stent thrombosis, stroke, etc., all-cause death. And you can see that, again, they are non-inferior in terms of collective data. However, just one small little caveat, the final endpoint, which is stent thrombosis, that was probably the main or the problem with these medications a little bit. That's why the editorial that came with these meta-analyses say, and I quote, for patients at very high risk of stent thrombosis, a triple antiplatelet therapy or a triple antithrombotic strategy might be prudent, like probably a month of aspirin in addition to the DOAC plus the P2Y12 inhibitor. And this is what was discussed also yesterday. So all the endpoints are in favor, except probably 1 month of triple therapy might be prudent. The final part of the circle is reversal. And definitely with these medications, despite having the fact of low bleeding rate, there's still some patients who will come with the unwanted, the unwarranted, and the most fearful bleeding. An expert consensus on anticoagulation education task force in DOACs give us four or five definite indications to reverse these medications. Life-threatening bleeding, bleeding in a closed space or critical organ like brain and the eye, persistent major bleed despite local hemostasis, risk of recurrent bleed due to delayed NOAC clearance, and emergency surgery or intervention, surgery in someone who will need an acute surgery. And the pathway actually give us just three letters to follow, SAR. S for stop, so you stop the medication, A for look for an antidote, and R for restart. So once you get rid of the bleeding, remember that the medication was indicated for a good indication to prevent the stroke. So there is no fear of leaving that patient for months or years or weeks without restarting the medication. So SAR, stop, antidote, and restart is the rule for having a major bleed on DOAC. And in 2015, we have a specific reversal agent for dabigatran, which got the accelerated approval by the FDA. And that was based on interim data on reverse AD trial. We have Brax bend and Brax bind, and it looks at the it looks at the clearance of the medication once you give the medication. So once you give the medication, immediately within four hours, actually, that was the endpoint of the study, you get the level of the medication below the red line. So it is very clear. And this happens in two groups of medication. Group A, those who have uncontrolled bleeding, and group B, those who are undergoing emergency procedure that you cannot delay for 1 or 2 days or 3 days, which we do when we do the elective surgeries on these patients. So the four-hour primary endpoint, there was complete dabigatran reversal.
3 minutes, doctor.
And 90 days, I'm almost done. 90 days secondary endpoints actually showed the appropriate hemostasis and mortality benefit. And this is a medication that has thrombin affinity 350 times than Pradaxa. It has no intrinsic proagulant effect, and it has no contraindication. And finally, there is no dose adjustment or for age or clinical or renal impairment. So the best candidate for Brax bind, number one, life-threatening trauma and or bleed. Number two, immediate reversal, pre-emergency surgery. And you can get, you can be assured that you will have very rapid reversal of the medication and perfect operable hemostasis. 93% of the patients rated by the surgeon that there was perfect operative hemostasis. So to conclude, the dabigatran and atrial fibrillation patient, now you have reliable data, extended rely, six years beyond the original trial on safety and efficacy in preventing stroke, systemic embolization in non-valvular AFib patient. You have two doses. And when the patient sustains acute coronary syndrome and undergoes PCI, now you can choose the medication with another antiplatelet agent. And definitely now you have the emergency reversal antidote of the medication, which will be available in Jordanian hospitals this Sunday, free of charge. Thank you.
I have a question, Dr. Ayman. Assume a 65-year-old person presenting to your office. He has atrial fibrillation, CHAD VAS score of 4, and he is not necessarily prone for bleeding. And we have 3 drugs on the market here. Probably internationally, we have 4. How do you go about in choosing which DOAC to give to the patient?
So we have a 60-year-old with CHAD VAS score 4, and you want to choose a DOAC. I use the 3 of them. In the absence, as we said yesterday, and probably the same answer will come every time we discuss comparison, in the absence of a head-to-head comparison, definitely you cannot say which one you prefer. However, with the dose of the superiority in terms of which medication is superior to warfarin, i.e. not only non-inferior, the dabigatran in the RISE study, the 150 twice daily, was a similar rate of bleeding. So you said the patient has low risk of bleeding, that's reassuring. And now you have the 150 BID has the edge over warfarin standard dose. So that will probably will push me toward using this medication. So I will look at the bleeding risk, and I will look at those who have very high thrombotic background, left main disease, multiple stents, acute coronary syndrome, stent thrombosis, small vessels, etc. So probably you tend to choose something that was shown to be superior to the classical VKA treatment.
Thank you. One question, and short, if there is one. There is none. Thank you.
Thank you so much.